just sure as shit, just like that, you know, like, you're an idiot, you know. So right after I shared that in a meeting, one of these guys had like 15 years. I used to call him Miserable Doug was his name, his guy over there. He died a few years ago, but he's always talking about Vietnam this, Vietnam that. But the guy raised his hand, and he talked about being on the edge of a drink, and he was an arm's length away from his next drink, and he only had 24 hours, and he had 15 years, and he still only got one day. And I said, you know, those are great little cliches, but that's not what it's about. I got 15 flipping years right now, and that's all there is to it. I plan on putting 30 years between me and that last drink, and I'm going to stay on this path toward God's will. So it kind of hurt because he had more time than me. I only had like 8 years at the time, and he had 15 years at the time, I remember. And I went to my sponsor who was at that meeting. That's why I went there, was for my sponsor. And I said, did you hear that guy, what he said? And I said, why did he say something like that? He goes, you know why he said something like that? Because that's where he's at in his sobriety. He says, that's where you're at in your sobriety, and that's where he's at in his sobriety. You want to stay sober for the rest of your life and put a strong defense between you and that first drink to where you never have to worry about taking that drink again. As long as you stay on this path toward God's will, you got nothing to fear. And that guy is teetering on the edge of a drink. He only has 24 hours. He is taboo. If he ever says he'll never drink again, the next day, he'll be drunk. And when he said that, I go, phew. And that's why I asked you to be my sponsor. He had like 40 years of sobriety when this was like, I don't know, 6 or 7 years ago, whatever it was. I think he's got like 45 now, 43, 45 years. I don't remember. But that was one of the things that really made me feel good about my feeling that I will never drink again. Because I remember people saying things like that. Anyway, so that really is the fifth step. It's a simple step. And step six, remember, the fifth step is on four pages, 72, 73, 74, and 75. Those four pages are the fifth step, and the directions for it, basically all they're doing is telling you to take your fourth step and show it to your sponsor. And to take it a little further, my sponsors reminded me of why we were doing the fourth step, to find and be rid of the things that were blocking me from doing God's will. It's really a simple idea, and why so many people fail at it is because they just don't do it, and that's all there is to it. What it says for step six is on page 76, and it says, just to back up a little bit into step five, carefully reading the first five proposals, we ask if we have omitted anything on page 75 at the bottom there. For we are building an arch through which we shall walk a free man at last. Is our work solid so far? Are the stones properly in place? Have we skimped on the cement put into the foundations? Have we tried to make mortar without sand? I guess what he's saying there is just, you know, maybe he built a house somewhere or something. And he's trying to make an analogy to the strong foundation for your sobriety. If we can answer to our satisfaction, we then look at step six. If we have emphasized willingness as being indispensable, are we now ready to let God remove from us all things which we have admitted are objectionable? Can He now take them all, every one? If we still cling to something we will not let go, we ask God to help us be willing. And this is step seven right here. Right, not even, you know, maybe a paragraph and a half. When ready, we say something like this. And step seven basically is just a prayer. Why he split the two up and made them two different steps, I don't know. Maybe 12 was a nice round number. Or maybe he just liked part one and part two of this step here. When ready, we say something like this. My Creator, I am now willing that you should have all of me, good and bad. This is the seventh step prayer. Good and bad. I pray that you now remove from me every single defect of character which stands in the way of my usefulness to you and my fellows. Grant me strength as I go from here to do your bidding. Amen. We have then completed step seven. That's how simple it is. But remember, take all these steps, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and 9, and lump them into one little pile, because that is the process of steps 10 and step 11. Within those inventories of step 10 and step 11 are 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and 9, lumped into one little sweeping movement of making the... I think Jim B. used to say, recognized, written down, shared with somebody else, turned over to God equals no fear. However, we have the solution. One thing that I don't think that most people bring up enough in AA meetings is that the fourth step, the tenth step, and the 11th step are our inventories. The fourth is for the past, to get an understanding of how we acted and how we behaved, that we were selfish and self-centered, and even when we thought that we were doing things for other people, underlying there really was a selfish motive under that, because I expected somehow to get paid back one way or another. And when I didn't, I was resentful, I was angry, I said, I'll never do anything for you again, you know. And that's basically, it cancels out that act. If there's a selfish motive underneath doing something for somebody, it cancels it out. From the standpoint of, we're trying to do God's will and find and do things for other people because we care about Him. Not because, I heard somebody say, look, matter of fact, I think it was Jim B. said, you come to a point in your sobriety when you do these things, when you go out and you do things for other people, not because I feel I'm going to drink if I don't, but because I really want to. At some point in my life, I'm expected to come to this point and say, you know, I'm going to do something for these people in my life, whether it's recovering alcoholics or people that are close to me, family, friends, and co-workers, employer, whatever. Those people in my life, I'm going to do something for them because I really do care about them. Not because I think, well, if I don't do it, I'm going to drink. Jeez, you know, that's not the right reason. At some point, I'm supposed to think to myself, it's time to stop being the child and grow up, and to become the adult that God intended me to be. And that's one of the things I wanted to bring up again tonight, too, was the God's will thing. That the whole concept of what's going on here is this two opposite ends of the spectrum, the God's will and the self-will. Look in step 5 where he says he admitted the exact nature of our wrongs. Look in step 10 where he says continued to take personal inventory, and when we were wrong, promptly admitted it. I remember sitting in an AA meeting one night, and I was sort of half asleep. I was listening to everybody talking, and somebody had started off, the third or fourth person that night had started off talking about being at their house, and they were having an argument with his wife or something, and deep down inside he knew he was really wrong in that argument, so he had to go home and admit that he was wrong. When he was wrong, promptly admitted it. And that's when I sort of came out of my fog, and I said, dude, man, that is not what that means. I had to raise my hand and throw this guy under the bus. I said, look, this is not about being wrong in an argument. This is about God's will is right and self-will is wrong. When I was wrong, I promptly admitted it. When I was selfish and self-centered and thinking of myself, that was wrong. I must promptly admit it. Okay? And step 5, you admitted to God, to yourself, and to another human being the exact nature of your wrongs. Selfishness, self-centeredness, resentment, fear. Selfishness, dishonesty, resentment, and fear. I missed that for years before somebody else said that, and I said, wow, now it makes sense. All this time, I thought that too for a couple of years, that somehow I was going to have an argument with somebody and I was going to be wrong and I should have promptly admitted it because it wasn't right, you know. And man, that was a strikeout right there. But I'd like to bring that up because, you know, I don't know, probably about 5 or 6 years ago was when that came to me, through somebody else, by the way. And all the stuff I bring up in AA meetings didn't come from my head. What comes out of my head is let's go have a drink and, you know, smoke a doob or something. This stuff that I try to teach in AA meetings is a result of the 12th step for me. It says that I try to, you know, practice these principles in all my affairs. I do my inventory because how can I explain to you something if I don't know how to do it myself? You understand that? How can I explain to you how to fix something that's broken, whether it's generators or drills or cars or, you know, airplanes, whatever it is that's broke. Someone who knows how to work on those things is going to know whether I know what I'm talking about or not. Therefore, you have to practice the principles in all your affairs and then, you know, teach these to other people. How's it put it in step 12? It says, practice these, or carry the message to alcoholics, is what it's saying. And what message is that? The message is, you know, I know we're not on step 12, but I consider all these steps to be sort of like a one sweeping movement of 12 parts of one step for me. That's what it is for me now. I've been doing this for so many years. It says, having had a spiritual awakening as a result of these steps. What spiritual awakening are we talking about? That I was selfish and self-centered and thought only of myself and not other people. And that's what that spiritual awakening is. That's not what God intended me to do. This is a spiritual idea that God intended me to grow into an adult and to be an adult. And at some time, I was supposed to make that transition. My first sponsor used to say, when did you start drinking? I said, I don't know, about 13 or something. He said, that's right. You know, that's about the answer that everybody gives, give or take a year or two, with 13 years of age. So what is it that happens to a human being that takes place in all of our lives at about that time? puberty. We were supposed to go from a child, that childish behavior of resentment, fear, selfishness, and dishonesty, into an adult where you didn't have those things and you had genuine concern for other people and you did things for people because you wanted to, not because you felt the reprisals or the what he said to me, my first sponsor, was that really what's going on with these steps is we're teaching each other how to grow up, what it means to behave like an adult. And in order to do that, we must first get an understanding of how we're behaving as a child. Therefore, I can't read Bill Wilson's fourth step and say, well, yeah, I guess that's right. Because when I did the fourth step, I might have had in my head this thought that said, you know, resentment and fear, selfishness and dishonesty may very well be what's wrong with you, but I'm somehow not buying it, you see. Because if I could just go back to the day when I could drink normal and I could have one or two and hang out and it was fun, and if I could get back to that point, I'll be just fine. Little did I know